In 3 days, Antifa and the right will be protesting together. Why? Because Virginia is a test case for tyranny, which the rest of the country might experience in the form of 3 anti-gun bills, and enough people are mad that the bitch-ass governor declared a state of emergency to stop them from mixing their First Amendment with their Second Amendment and block an armed open carry protest with both of them in the Capitol. So, what are the bills that have people so angry, and what do they mean to the broader picture of the political landscape? Let's get into that. Now, to be clear, one of these bills already existed in a form. In 1987, as part of the Title 18.2, Crimes and Offenses Generally, Chapter 9, Crimes Against Peace and Order, Article 8, Unlawful Paramilitary Activity, Subsection 18.2-4.33.2, Paramilitary Activity Prohibited, Virginia had already enacted the following restrictions. Quote, a person shall be guilty of unlawful paramilitary activity punishable as a Class 5 felony if he, 1, teaches or demonstrates to any other person the use, application, or making of any firearm, explosive, or incendiary device, or technique capable of causing injury or death to persons, knowing or having reason to know or intending that such training will be employed for use in or in furtherance of a civil disorder, or 2, assembles with one or more persons for the purpose of training with, practicing with, or being instructed in the use of any firearm, explosive, or incendiary device, or technique capable of causing injury or death to persons intending to employ such training for use in or in furtherance of a civil disorder. So what does Virginia Senate Bill 64 do then? 2 major things. It adds a third clause to that subsection, stating that it will now be a felony under the same legal structure to, quote, assemble with one or more persons with the intent of intimidating any person or group of persons by drilling, parading, or marching with any firearm, any explosive or incendiary device, or any components or combination thereof, and changing shall be to is. And this is just the first bill. We have 2 more to go over. Well, fuck. With no tight definition of intimidation, this basically bans all open carry activities. Because the purpose of open carry activities could be considered intimidation of the state. And it's not like they were specific about the necessary targets here. And given that this bill is also a reenactment of a bill which banned paramilitary activity in 1987, it basically fully criminalized the Second Amendment. I mean, a lot of people have pointed to the, quote, for the purposes of civil disorder part to claim it's only to stop terrorists and the like. But those people are stupid cucks, and here's why. First, they miss the word or. That or delineates a line between the first paragraph and the second, and this amendment to the bill removes it entirely. Similarly, they miss the word shall be, turning into is. This change further cements the legal rigidity which this amendment seeks to empower the state. Without the separation of those 2 paragraphs, it could be argued that anyone doing items 2 or 3 is necessarily engaging in civil disorder. And notice the technique part 2. This means that anyone in Virginia would be breaking the law by teaching any fighting whatsoever if they did it as a part of broader training in militia activities and the like. It's also worth noting that even though Snopes is quick to discard this claim, the claim is still true based on an arbitrary and undefined category of civil disorder, and could just amount to disobedience, meaning any martial arts studio not towing the line is treading thin ice. Anything more than that is likely already over it, and this is just scratching the surface of all the potential things reenactment of this bill would do, in addition to its amendments. And it's only one of the bills I'll be going over today. So, let's hit the other 2. In one bill, they expand the definition of assault weapon, which, by the way, those don't exist. And in another, they ban them altogether. So let's talk about the first one, which has already been stricken or shut down after an NRA lobby day a few days ago. SB 16 would have done the following, quote, prohibiting sale, transport, etc. of assault firearms and certain firearm magazines, penalties, expands the definition of assault firearm and prohibits any person from importing, selling, transferring, manufacturing, purchasing, possessing, or transporting an assault firearm. A violation is a Class 6 felony. The bill prohibits a dealer from selling, renting, trading, or transferring from his inventory an assault firearm to any person. The bill also prohibits a person from carrying a shotgun with a magazine that will hold more than 7 rounds of the longest ammunition for which it is chambered in a public place. Under existing law, this prohibition applies only in certain localities. The bill makes it a Class 1 misdemeanor to import, sell, barter, or transfer any firearm magazine designed to hold more than 10 rounds of ammo. So, basically, any weapon that could do some damage to the state could not be carried, even if you weren't intimidating anyone. Well, that got shut down, and good thing, too. But before you go celebrating, you should know that this victory was likely a decoy. Because another, bigger, badder piece of legislation is still waiting in the wings. And this one is so much worse, it's stunning. House Bill 961 does the following. Prohibiting sale, transport, etc. of assault firearms, certain firearm magazines, silencers, and trigger activators. Expands the definition of assault firearm and prohibits any person from importing, selling, transferring, manufacturing, purchasing, possessing, or transporting an assault firearm. A violation is a Class 6 felony. The bill prohibits a dealer from selling, renting, trading, or transferring from his inventory an assault firearm to any person. The bill also prohibits a person from carrying a shotgun with a magazine that will hold more than 7 rounds of the longest ammunition for which it's chambered in a public place under existing law. This prohibition applies only in certain localities. The bill makes it a Class 6 felony to import, sell, transfer, manufacture, purchase, possess, or transport large-capacity firearm magazines, silencers, and trigger activators, all defined in the bill. Any person who legally owns an assault firearm, large-capacity firearm magazine, silencer, or trigger activator on July 1st, 2020, may retain possession until January 1st, 2021. During that time, such person shall 1. Render the assault firearm, large-capacity firearm magazine, silencer, or trigger activator inoperable. 2. Remove the assault firearm, large-capacity firearm magazine, silencer, or trigger activator away from the Commonwealth. 3. Transfer the assault firearm, large-capacity firearm magazine, silencer, or trigger activator to a person outside the Commonwealth who is not prohibited from possessing it. Or 4. Surrender the assault firearm, large-capacity firearm magazine, silencer, or trigger activator to a state or local law enforcement agency. The bill further states that any person who legally owns an assault firearm on July 1st, 2020, may retain possession of such assault firearm after July 1st, 2021, if such person has obtained permit from the Department of State Police to possess an assault firearm in accordance with procedures established in this bill. A person issued such permit may possess an assault firearm only under the following conditions. A. While in his home or on his property, or while on the property of another who has provided prior permission, provided that the person has the landowner's written permission on his person while on such property. B. While at a shooting range, shooting gallery, or other area designated for the purpose of target shooting or the target range of a public or private club or organization whose members have organized for the purpose of practicing shooting targets or competing in target shooting matches. C. While engaged in lawful hunting, or D. While surrendering the assault firearm to a state or local law enforcement agency. A person issued such permit may also transport an assault firearm between any of those locations, provided that such assault firearm is unloaded and secured within a closed container while being transported. The bill also provides that failure to display the permit and a photo identification upon demand by a law enforcement officer shall be punishable by a $25 civil penalty, which shall be paid into the state treasury. The bill also requires the Department of State Police to enter the name and description of a person issued a permit into the Virginia Criminal Information Network so that the permit's existence and current status will be made known to the law enforcement personnel accessing VSIN for investigative purposes. End quote. So basically, it's the other bill with a grandfather clause, but only for citizens who beg the state to let them keep their guns and only so long as the state knows all the guns a citizen owns. It's a statewide gun registry and confiscation program, and it would severely hamper any significant rebellion in the area, even if the original bill I referenced weren't a thing. Gun rights groups have been up in arms about all this, and rightly so. The Second Amendment is a national law, but states have been neutering the intent of the provision since the country has existed, and now Virginia wants to basically be California. All they need, if this passes, is a provision like California's where you have to get a background check for ammo, and the state which once said sic semper tyrannis will be reduced to, okay, I guess we have tyrannis now. This is why even Antifa have sided against these Democrats. A local and extremely large chapter has made it clear that this aggression will not stand, and has made plans to show to the demonstration in a few days. From Vice, quote, when gun lovers rally in front of the Virginia Capitol in Richmond next week, the local chapter of Antifa will be there too. But their members won't be wearing all black, and they don't plan to douse right-wingers in milkshakes or silly string. Instead, local Antifa will join thousands of conservatives who are expected to descend on Richmond that day in protesting pending gun control legislation introduced by Democratic lawmakers. Antifa Seven Hills, based in Richmond, are opposing the slew of gun bills introduced by the newly Democratic legislature since November, because they say those types of laws are used primarily to criminalize poor people, minorities, and leftists, and to bolster law enforcement's power. It continues, quote, the local Antifa chapter's engagement in this issue is another example of the resurgence of pro-gun leftists in America, and yet more evidence that the gun rights debate is growing increasingly politically diffuse and nuanced beyond simply being a GOP issue. Under the Trump administration, and in response to the emergence of an emboldened far-right movement, leftist gun groups have surged. For example, the Socialist Rifle Association was formed in 2018 and today has over 50 chapters across the country. Similarly, Redneck Revolt, a leftist gun group that formed in 2016, claims at least 45 chapters nationwide. So, basically, the left and the right both know one thing for certain. The more power the state has, the less we have. And for once, they're deciding to work together on an issue, even though they seek different conclusions. This is the essence of my anarcho-coalitionism idea, but that's a topic for another day. Point is, the right in this protest knows that the moment you have a disparity between the arms the state possesses and the ones you have, tyranny can take hold. And the protesting leftists know that entrenched power thrives off the gradual disarmament of the people, especially since it disproportionately hits racial and religious minorities, and also the poor, meaning it's a good way for fascism to take root. They get it. And they're pissed. One doesn't have to think too hard to know why Trump's been pretty silent on this either. He's a gun grabber too, and is famous for saying we should be disarmed prior to any due process. He doesn't give a fuck about the Constitution, and neither does the government of Virginia. So when all this became obvious and a rally was scheduled for the 20th, what did this bitch-ass Governor Ralph Northam do? He declared a state of emergency. Yeah, sound like any presidents we know? Didn't get what he wanted immediately, so he used a state of emergency to stymie opposition? Anyway, he said, we have received credible intelligence from our law enforcement agencies that there are groups with malicious plans for the rally that is planned for Monday. Then he enacted the state of emergency, which bans guns on the properties where the rally is to be held. He cried about out-of-state militia groups and hate groups planning to travel from across the country to disrupt our democratic process with acts of violence. He said, They are coming to intimidate and to cause harm. So there you have it. If you want a picture of how the new addendum to legislation could look, this is it. Not only would he be able to declare a state of emergency, but he could perform mass arrests of protesters like this, calling it intimidation to engage in your lawfully protected rights to assembly, speech, and bearing of arms. He's terrified of the left and right coming at him and the new blue state government for their goal of enacting fascist gun control, and he wants the ability to prevent anything like this from happening again. He demands they disavow violence, but there's the rub, and it's a rub I've brought up countless times now. I can't tell you how many times I've brought up a victim of police brutality or the military-industrial complex, only so that someone can claim they deserved it because they were armed. Happened so many fucking times now. This normally comes from rightists, mad I'm not backing the blue or supporting the troops. But this situation in Virginia highlights why I don't give a fuck. So what if the citizens are armed? If you don't tread on them, the guns will remain slung over their backs, so what's the problem? Moreover, as I've brought up with cops and troops, yeah, people might be armed some of the time. You know who else is armed all the time? Fucking cops and troops. So why is our being armed an excuse to kill us, but them being armed isn't an excuse for their deaths? Well, because the state is a monopoly on violence. That's why. They get to be violent, and you don't. The whole experiment of mind control for 7 decades now, from the paperclip imported scientists to the Macy's Foundation to MKUltra and all its myriad permutations, it was all geared toward controlling violence. Watch The Minds of Men by True Stream Media for more. David Grossman, that pig I mentioned in my other vid who wants to train cops to be instant killers so they can come better, even wanted to be able to turn it off and on like a faucet. The state is in the business of controlling, refining, and isolating violence, so it's always used to control the lower classes. They know as long as they maintain their monopoly on violence, they can push whatever control they want for whoever's profit or other benefit they'd like, and people will just have to take it. But make no mistake, every law is a lifted gun, with consequences up to and including death for disobedience. Someone has already been killed over a red flag raid, and all Virginia would need to do with a registry of this sort is get red flag laws on the books, which VCDL believes they'll need to fight in 2020, in order to begin violently stripping peaceful citizens of their guns under the guise of preventing violence. So if you're a citizen of Virginia, they're pointing guns at all of you, and look down upon your insolence from their ivory towers. They're happy to see you fight each other on the ground level, but they never want you to point your barrels upward. They fear the power of solidarity and coalition, and they see it happening now, and worse, there happens to be a drill that is totally not crisis actors in a false flag, which is being requested near there soon. Just another thing to add to your reasons to stay frosty. Not saying this is guaranteeably related, but it's facts. So, I wish everyone over there well. Use this new power of unity, and remember who the real enemies are. Those usurpers of your freedom, redcoats, who'd have helped kill the founders had they lived in colonial America. Fascists in disguise, who require the disarmament of the people who they wish to oppress. Just like many other historical dictators. Those are your enemies. And rightly so. People are starting to see their chains, and I applaud it. Now it's your task to begin the slow, exhausting power of shaking them off. But don't spend all your energy here either. After this fight, there are many more freedoms you could reattain. And maybe, someday, be free at last. Wouldn't that be something?